Good morning and welcome to worship this morning. We will settle in and prepare our hearts to worship with this video. Welcome to each one of you this morning and those who are joining with us online as we come together and gather for worship. A few announcements that I would like to share with you this morning. Firstly, this is Judy's last Sunday with us, as Kate will be joining us again next week. And so Judy, on behalf of the congregation, I would like to extend all of our thanks to you for sharing your passion and your enthusiasm for music with us over the months of July and August. Thank you so very much. And also our church office administrator, Jody, will be back on Tuesday. And so a thanks to Crystal, who was filling in for Jody over the past 3 weeks. And we hope Jody and Jeff had a wonderful time away. Well, one of the most beloved and important aspects of our Sunday morning experience is not just the worship service, but the time of fellowship and coffee and refreshments following the worship service. I remember when we were deep in the lockdown during COVID, we participated in a congregational survey, and one of the questions that we asked in that survey was, what are the main things that you miss about coming, not being able to come to Knox? And a close second, and a very close second after the worship service, was the coffee hour after the worship service. It is a time that we love when we can get together, share refreshments, but that's just really the thing that draws us together and allows us to share in a time of conversation. So we are looking for some more volunteers to sign up to help with coffee hour. So there is a list on the coffee table at the back, and there are many of us around that could answer any questions that you might have about volunteering for that. But an important aspect is everything's provided. You don't have to bring in refreshments. It's all here. All you have to do is help Sandy, our coffee hour host, in putting the items out and getting ready beforehand and then cleaning up afterwards. So we're here to help if you have any questions about volunteering about that. Today we continue our Drawn In, Exploring God Through Creativity sermon series. And today's message is called Risk. So far in this series, we've discussed the importance of rest in the process of being creative. You can't really be creative if you're not experiencing God through times of rest as well. We discovered how all creativity begins with a dream, and we talked about aligning our dream with God's dream. Last week, we looked at the concept of perception, with the realization that life doesn't always go the way we had planned or the way we had hoped. But sometimes the detours and the changes in plan along the journey can lead to joy. It's all up to our perception of God in the midst of those detours and changes. And today we're going to talk about how taking creative risks can lead to a new understanding of God, of faith, and of ourselves. Well, to call us to worship this morning, I'd like to share with you these words of courage in the midst of times of risk-taking from the prophet Isaiah, who said, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And these words from American playwright Neil Simon, who said, "If no one ever took risks, Michelangelo would have painted the Sistine floor." And the great cellist Yo-Yo Ma, who wrote, "Passion is one great force that unleashes creativity, because if you're passionate about something, then you're more willing to take risks." So with passionate faith, I invite you to join with me in prayer, which will be followed by the Lord's Prayer in unison, and today we're using the Sins version. So let's pray together. God of creative risk-taking love, we thank you for taking risks with us, for creating each one of us with diverse and unique traits, thoughts, and perceptions. We are each distinct, but we come together as one family, seeking your guidance, desiring your direction, and drawing upon your strength and courage to lead us. As you take risks with us, help us to do the same with one another, accepting, welcoming, and loving each other while honoring and expecting our distinct natures. We each have come to this time of worship with our own worries, hopes, frustrations, and joys. Minister to us as we minister to each other, and use this time of worship to help us explore our creative spirits, taking risks to encounter you in unique and creative ways. And we ask this, uniting our voices together with the prayer of Jesus. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And we'll now join together to sing hymn number 374, O 4,000 Tongues to Sing. Children way in the back, and if you want you can come up, but you can stay in the back too, because you'll be able to see everything in this on the screen, whatever works best for you. Well, over these weeks, you know, we've been talking about creativity, and today we're going to talk about the idea that creativity takes risks. Now, what are some ideas that you have of something that might be risky, something that takes a risk? Can you think of something that is risky? Nicholas? What was that? Mountain biking. Good one. Climbing. That's even riskier, I would say. That's right. Mountain climbing is riskier. Any risky activities or things that you guys can think of? I can remember when I was a kid, I made a ramp. My brother and I made a ramp, and we would ride our bikes over that ramp. Thankfully, no broken bones were involved, but I would not try that today. What about jumping off the diving board at the pool, maybe at the sportsplex? Nicholas? What's that? Can you yell that out?
A front flip?
Off the diving board, that would be risky, especially doing it for the very first time. Has anybody gone down the twirly slide at the sportsplex? I think that's risky. I don't know that I would do that these days. I think that is a risky activity. Well, maybe you guys have taken some risks this summer. I know some of you went to summer camp for the very first time. That's a risky activity, and you did really, really well. Some of you were back at summer camp. It's old hat for you. But every time you try something new, that's risky, isn't it? Well, creativity involves taking a risk. And so today we're going to hear another story from Peter H. Reynolds. So we've got his books here that we've looked at over the previous weeks about taking a risk. Now, you might remember in last week's story, there was a character called Marisol. It was Ramon's sister, who was very encouraging, and Ramon had decided to give up being creative, give up his artwork because of a nasty comment his brother had made. But Marisol had created this gallery of all of her brother's works, and that gave him the encouragement to keep going, even if his artwork was ish. And we all like to cling to that word, ish, because sometimes life is ishy. Well, today we're going to take a look at Sky Color, and the main character in Sky Color is Marisol. So I'm going to read it from here, but the pictures will appear on the screen. So Sky Color by Peter H. Reynolds. Marisol was an artist. She loved to draw and paint, and she even had her very own art gallery. It's on the fridge. Not all her art hung in a gallery. Much of it she shared with the world. She painted posters to share ideas she believed in. At school, Marisol was famous for her creative clothes, her box of art supplies, and her belief that everyone was an artist. Yes, Marisol was an artist through and through, so when her teacher told the class they were going to paint a mural for the library, Marisol couldn't wait to begin. The classroom buzzed with the sound of brainstorming. The students talked and sketched. Together they made a great big drawing. Then they marched to the library. "I'll paint a fish. I'll paint one too. I'll paint the ocean," Marisol shouted. "I'll paint the sky." Marisol rummaged through the box of paint, but could not find any blue. "How am I going to make the sky without blue paint?" The bell rang. It was time to put their brushes down for the day. As she climbed aboard the bus, Marisol kept wondering. All the way home, she stared out the window. The sun lowered closer to the horizon. Later at home, Marisol watched day turn into night. That night, Marisol settled into a deep dream. She drifted through a sky swirling with colors, the colors mixed, making too many to count. In the morning, Marisol stood waiting for the bus in the rain. The sky was not blue. She smiled. At school, Marisol raced to the library. She grabbed a dish and began adding colors, this one, that one. She swirled the brush to make an altogether new color. Marisol then began painting on the wall. A boy asked, "What color is that?" "That," Marisol said, "that is sky color. There's no blue in that sky, is there?" So what was the risk that Marisol made in her painting? Can you think of the risk that she took in painting the sky? Jeff?
I think that she just started
That's right. She decided just not to use blue. She decided to use all sorts of different colors, not the expected color. Whenever we're drawing and painting and we're looking at artwork, usually the sky is blue, isn't it? But Marisol discovered that the sky in real life isn't always blue. It can be gray. It can be a multitude of colors, especially at sunset. So she took a risk and she decided not to use the color blue in her drawing of the sky. And I think sometimes we think that things need to look a certain way, like the sky needs to be blue, or we think we need to act in certain ways in order to be right, in order to be correct. But over these past few weeks, as we've been talking about creativity, we are discovering that being creative means taking risks, and that might mean doing things a different way, thinking a different way, and perhaps discovering God in new and different ways, not just in the tried and true where we expect to find God or how we expect to find God, but seeing God in different places and in different people. God is our creator, but God is also an example of a risk taker. God didn't just make the sky blue, but God also made it shades of purple and orange, red and yellow. God didn't just make flowers red, but God made them pink and yellow and lavender. And God didn't make us all the same either, but God took a risk and gave us all individual ideas, opinions, likes, and dislikes. And as partners with God in creating, because we are all creators, as we're discovering, we are invited to take risks too. So we are going to take a risk at our creativity corner this morning. It's set up in the back for us to explore after the service. We are going to make sky scenes, and like Marisol, there's no blue back there. So we are going to make sky scenes using dark pieces of paper. Some of it's construction paper, some of it's sort of a different type of thick paper. And there's chalk back there. So you can be really creative with your chalk, create a sky scene, and see if you can take a risk and do it without using blue. Let's pray together. Creative God, thank you for taking risks when you created the world and all that is in it. Thank you that we aren't all the same, but are unique in our thoughts, our opinions, our likes and our dislikes. That is truly what makes our world so interesting. So help us to be creative risk takers too, so we can partner with you in creating a world that is diverse, unique, and beautiful. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Have fun at Sunday school and maybe take a risk or two.
Thank you. The first reading is Psalm 123, which we'll read responsively, verse by verse. Supplication for mercy, a song of accents. To you I lift my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens. As the eyes of servants took to the hand of their master, as the eyes of a maid of the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look to the Lord our God, until he has mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy upon us, for we have had more than enough contempt. Our soul has had more than its fill of the scorn of those who are at ease, of the contempt of the proud. The second reading is 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. And when they say there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all light, children of light, and children of the day. We are not of the day or of darkness. So then, let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep at night and those who get drunk at night. And since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing.
Thank you, Carolyn. Our focus passage this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25, verses 14 to 30. For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, Master, you have handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And then the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours. But his master replied, You wicked and lazy slave. You knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. You know that's never a good thing. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God. Well, Misty Copeland is someone who knows what it's like to take risks, and she also knows what it's like to have others take risks for her. Misty Copeland was born in Kansas City, but she grew up in very tumultuous environments in various underprivileged communities as her mother moved Misty and her five siblings from place to place and relationship to relationship. But it was in one of those communities that Misty began attending a ballet class at the local Boys and Girls Club, where she drew the attention of one of the instructors who recognized in Misty a natural talent and a gift for dance. So the instructor took a risk and made it possible for Misty to attend a proper ballet school where her talent simply took off. And within 1 year, Copeland began studying with the American Ballet Theater. And in 2015, she became the first African-American woman to earn the title of principal dancer with the American Ballet Theater. Also, that same year in 2015, she was named one of the 100 most influential people in the world by Time Magazine, and she appeared on its cover. So she has since performed on Broadway. She's toured as a principal dancer for Prince, the singer, not the member of the royal family. And she's appeared on the reality show So You Think You Can Dance, all because an instructor recognized within her talent and took a risk. Well, Misty is now taking risks. She takes those risks regularly as she works with at-risk youth, serving as the ambassador for a nonprofit organization called Mind Leaps. And Mind Leaps provides dance-centered programs and remedial vocational training and education for at-risk youth in post-conflict and developing countries. And so Mind Leaps has worked extensively in Rwanda, Guinea, Bosnia-Herzegovina, and then they've recently expanded to Mauritania, Uganda, and Kenya. So the organization believes that connecting with at-risk youth through a shared love of dance and creativity will lead to safe spaces, academic opportunities, and lifelong skills development. So as its ambassador, Misty Copeland brings awareness to the important work of Mind Leaps, but she has also taken a risk in a young student from Rwanda named Ali. So Ali came to Mind Leaps after being found selling charcoal on the street. His mother had died, his father was missing, Ali couldn't read or write, and he couldn't even spell his name. After combining dance with remedial education at Mind Leaps, Ali was soon at the stage where he could succeed in a formal school environment. So Misty Copeland took a risk, provided him with a scholarship, and Ali completed his first term at a local boarding school, achieving a grade of 85%, which put him at the very top of his class. So an instructor took a risk on Misty Copeland. Misty has taken a risk with Ali, a risk that is allowing Ali to dance, to learn, and to grow. And so who knows what types of risks Ali might then take in the future. Well, Jesus shares a parable in today's scripture reading from Matthew that is all about taking risks. In fact, teaching through parables is a risk in itself because there never is one pat answer to a parable. We could look at this parable today and come up with one explanation. We might look at it again next year and come up with something completely different. Jesus used parables, though, to invite his listeners to broaden their understanding or their preconceived ideas about certain notions or teachings. So he would tell a story using familiar situations, then themes, but then he would add perhaps a little plot twist or a new concept, and then just leave it there and let the people sit with it a while and come up with their own conclusions. And we know that parables aren't literal events, so there really wasn't a master who gave all his earnings to three slaves and asked them to take care of it for them. But it's a story. It's a story with a theme, an overarching theme. It's a teaching tool that Jesus used to invite his followers to ponder what his new kingdom of justice, peace, and freedom might look like. It was also a teaching tool to allow them to figure out how to go forward and live out that faith for themselves. He didn't give them the answers, but he asked them to think. And in today's parable, we are invited to think about risk. So Jesus tells this story, this parable, during the last few days of his life. Earlier, he had made the decision to leave the safety of rural Galilee and risk going to Jerusalem, the capital city, where he was regarded as a threat to the religious status quo and a political disturber of the peace. And so it's in this risky environment that he tells this parable, intended to broaden our perspective, expand our understanding, and invite us to look at an issue from a creative and perhaps even a risky perspective. So the parable is about a wealthy man who goes away on a long journey, but before he sets out, he distributes his property to three slaves. And we read that it is a huge amount of money. So some commentaries will say that one talent is the equivalent of a lifetime's worth of wages. Some other commentaries say it's about 5 years of wages or 7 years of wages. Regardless, we know it is a large sum of money. So the first slave is given 5 talents, the second is entrusted with 2, and the third is given just 1 talent, but still, that is a massive amount of money. The first slave is a risk taker, and he invests those 5 talents in high-risk ventures, doubling his money. The second slave does the same, putting the money to work at high risk and again doubling the investment. The third slave takes a very different approach. He digs a hole in the ground and puts all the money in that hole, thinking he will keep it safe. And you know, from a financial perspective in an unstable economy, that's not actually a bad move. It might even be considered a very wise move. In a time of stock market decline, at least the money would be safe. PC USA minister and former editor of Christian Century publication, John Buchanan, he was a keynote speaker at a conference I attended some years ago in Toronto. He writes that third slave is not actually a bad person. This is a prudent, careful, cautious investor who is not about to take any risks with his master's money. And then when his master returns, it's all there. Not one penny has been lost. And the slave must have been quite proud of himself. He had kept that investment safe and secure in the ground. But the master is not impressed. And we read that he treats this third slave as harshly as anyone in the entire Bible, banishing him to the outer darkness where there is that weeping and gnashing of teeth. Buchanan wonders in his commentary what the master's response might have been had those first 2 slaves lost all of that master's money in those high-risk investments, if the stock market had crashed and they had lost every penny. Would the third slave, who took the easy route, then be the hero of the story? That's something for us to ponder, I guess, but that's not how Jesus tells it, because the point here has really nothing to do with the money. The point here is not about doubling your money and accumulating wealth. The point is definitely not about taking money away from the poor and piling it on top of the massive wealth of the rich, sort of like a reverse Robin Hood. The point is about living. It's about creativity. It's about taking risks. And it's about Jesus preparing his followers for a time when he will no longer be with them on the earth. And so how are they going to carry on his ministry, safely hiding it in the ground or creatively taking risks? And it turns out that the greatest risk of all in this story is not to risk anything at all, not to care deeply, not to love lavishly, not to live your life with such gratitude that you would risk everything. The greatest risk of all, it turns out, is to play it safe, to live cautiously and prudently, to be motivated by fear, as did that third servant. You'll notice that the message to the master from the first and second servants is the same. Those words are repeated from the first and the second servant. Master, you handed over me 5 talents, see, I've made 5 more. And then, Master, you've handed over me 2 talents, see, I've made 2 more. And then the response to those servants from the master is also the same. Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Prompting the idea that the amount of money is not the issue. Whether it was 5 talents or 2 talents, the master responded the same way. He could have responded the same way if it was 22 talents or 222 talents. Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. But the dialogue between the third servant and the master is completely different. The servant admits that he was fearful of the master, and that's why he chose the safe route of burying the master's assets so that nothing would happen to them. But as we said, the amount of money, the amount of that asset is not the point. The master had been generous with all 3 of them. But what he had hoped to see was how the servants would respond to that generosity. Would they share it? Would they multiply it? Would they see it grow? Or would they, like that third servant, respond in fear, choose the safe route, avoid the risk, and literally bury their talent in the sand so it would benefit no one? The risk-averse servant chose the easy route, the safe path, hence the weeping and the gnashing of teeth. I do not like taking risks. I don't like roller coasters. I would not be jumping over a ramp on my bike today, and I don't think I would even go down that twisty slide at the Sportsplex. But this parable, this story, challenges me and hopefully challenges us to consider that there are times when we need to take risks. And using what we have been given to benefit the lives of others is one of those times. The wealthy master was effusively generous with his talents, hoping that his servants would be equally generous in putting those talents to good use. So the parable seems to be making the point that God has entrusted each one of us with enormous talent, abilities, capabilities, creativity. We have the power to impact our environments, to enhance our communities, and to truly make a difference. God has given us life and time and people and the world. And the parable seems to suggest that God is interested in how we use what we have been so generously entrusted to use. Will we fearfully bury those gifts in the sand? or will we take a risk? It makes me think of the anonymous poem about the too cautious man. There was a very cautious man who never laughed or played. He never risked, he never tried, he never sang or prayed. And when one day he passed away, his insurance was denied, for since he never really lived, they claimed he never died. So we are challenged to take risks and live so that our insurance companies would have no question that we have lived. Take the risk in a relationship to go deeper, to be vulnerable, and to let your authentic self show. Take the chance to do something for someone who can't pay you back. Take the risk to go against the grain and stand up for people suffering injustice and intolerance. Take the risk to invest your time, your talent, and your treasure in things that truly matter. Take the risk and hear those words, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." Amen. We're going to ponder the value of taking risks during this time of reflection. Join together to sing the hymn, "Come Know My Joy, the Master Said," which is number 788.
Thank you.
seated. We'll now join together for the prayers of the people. Let's pray together. Creative God, there are times when we look at the world around us and we are overwhelmed with grief, fear, and anxiety. It can be hard to remember to be grateful for all the goodness in this world when around us we are confronted with wildfires out of control, damaging entire regions, forcing people out of their homes and communities. When we see other acts of climate change, when we see violence and war and hunger and pain, when we see the brokenness in our own families and maybe even within our own hearts. Remind us of your loving presence, which is made real in the people who surround us, the communities that sustain us, and creation which upholds us. And with this reminder of your presence, help us to take risks and invest our time, talent, and treasure in things that truly matter, visiting the lonely, feeding the hungry, housing the homeless, and bringing hope to the hopeless. Open our eyes that we might risk seeing your presence. Open our ears that we might risk hearing your call upon our lives. Open our hearts that we might risk loving others as you have loved us. Open our hands that we might risk serving as Jesus instructed us to serve. And we pray this in his name and for his sake. Amen. And we'll prepare to go out into the world to risk having our eyes and our ears and our hands and our hearts opened to serve God with the hymn number 634, Will You Come and Follow Me? Go now into this new week, not knowing what it will hold, but knowing that we are being held by God's loving spirit. Take a risk and share that spirit of love with others, following in the footsteps of Jesus, who shows us the way. Amen.